السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, received a revelation. La ilaha illa ana fattakhizni wakila. This means that there is no God but me, so take me alone as your guardian. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, on whom be peace, has been reassured by God the Almighty in this revelation that he need not look in any other direction, for God the Almighty is the one who would cater for and adorn all his tasks. God the Almighty would further all the works and the mission of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, on whom be peace. God the Almighty is saying in this revelation to the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, that he alone is the guardian over all the promised Messiah, peace be upon him's endeavors. He would provide the necessary means and resources for those endeavors to be accomplished. Since the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, had made God the Almighty his point of worship, and God the Almighty had sent the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, to propagate his religion, thus the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, should not fret, nor should the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, worry, as God the Almighty has the power to facilitate all his tasks, and God the Almighty would do so. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has briefly explained this revelation himself, and he says, in other words, this means that God says, I alone am the one who will make all your tasks come to pass. So thus understand that I am your guardian and doer of all your efforts. Do not think that anyone else has the slightest influence in your endeavors being fulfilled. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, says, after receiving this revelation, I became terrified and shaken, lest God the Almighty did not even deem it worthy to refer to my Jamaat, or my community, by name. So thus here the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, drew the attention of the community to the fact that the revelation reminds every member that God the Almighty stands in no need whatsoever of their services. God the Almighty does not require the help of the members of the community nor their support, and God the Almighty does not stand in need of their sacrifices. Since God the Almighty himself established this Jamaat, that is, this community, thus he would also provide all the means to make it progress and succeed. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, admonished the members of the community that they should thoroughly understand that the opportunity they have been given to serve was purely out of the grace and blessings of Allah the Almighty. With the grace of God the Almighty, members of the community realized this truth, and to acquire divine bounties and blessings, were ready to offer any sacrifice to help further the mission of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. Financial sacrifices were a part of this, and the members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community demonstrated incredible examples to this end. From the life of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, until today, members of the community continue to display these lofty models of financial sacrifice. Those members of the community who gave these sacrifices never deemed it to be a favor on the community. Rather, they thanked God the Almighty in gratitude for being given the opportunity to offer these sacrifices. In addition, this revelation indicates that the system of Khilafat that would be established after the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, should always keep in view that God the Almighty would constantly bring about ease in all tasks and efforts, but this would be if efforts are made to fulfill the right of the servitude to God. This would be if full trust is kept in God the Almighty alone. This would be if help is sought from only him, and this would be if one relies in none other than God the Almighty himself. By doing this, God the Almighty would always cater and adorn all tasks himself. He would cause them to be fulfilled, and he would provide the necessary means and resources to that end, inshallah ta'ala, God willing. As I have said earlier, we continue to witness the support of God the Almighty even today. He constantly instills the importance of sacrifice into the hearts of Ahmadis, who subsequently demonstrate extraordinary examples. In the community, there is the system of Vasiyat and the system of Janda Am. In addition, various financial appeals are made from time to time, in which members display astonishing models of sacrifice. There are two institutions or financial appeals that are ongoing and are permanent. In other words, Tehreek-e-Jadeed and Waqf-e-Jadeed. Waqf-e-Jadeed was initially limited to only Pakistan, but was later extended to cover the entire world. Later still, Waqf-e-Jadeed expanded and developed tremendously. We find exceptional models of sacrifice being demonstrated by members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community in the field of Waqf-e-Jadeed. As all are aware, when this appeal of Waqf-e-Jadeed was first launched, it was with the purpose to facilitate and progress tabligh and tarbiyat, that is, preaching and also moral and spiritual training, in remote areas and in villages of Pakistan. When Waqf-e-Jadeed was expanded to the entire world, it continued to maintain specific objectives and aims, and money was to be spent on particular areas and regions. Those regions in the initial period when Waqf-e-Jadeed first expanded to the world included India, Africa, and areas in other poor and impoverished countries. And so the appeal was made to galvanize tabligh and tarbiyat, preaching and moral and spiritual training in these areas. A young relative asked me a question that if Waqf-e-Jadeed was previously limited to Pakistan, but it now covers the entire world, what purpose does keeping Tehreek-e-Jadeed established serve? It is quite possible that the same question may arise in the minds of others as to why so many financial appeals or institutions are required, and so I shall briefly explain this. As I have mentioned, the expenditure for Waqf-e-Jadeed only covers specific countries and regions. Normally, when money is received from Western and wealthy countries under the category of Waqf-e-Jadeed, it is spent in remote and village areas of India and Africa. In fact, when Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV, expanded Waqf-e-Jadeed to the whole world, he had this very purpose in mind. The objective of initiating Waqf-e-Jadeed in the wealthier countries was so that the expenditure for Qadian and India should be covered through Waqf-e-Jadeed, whereas the expenditure for Tehreek-e-Jadeed covers the entire world, wherever help is needed from the Markaz, that is the center or the headquarters. Thus, money is received in the center or the headquarters and then spent accordingly. Nonetheless, there are a large number of projects and endeavors being fulfilled through Waqf-e-Jadeed in the poor or underdeveloped nations. In the 1st or 2nd January of every year, the new year of Waqf-e-Jadeed is announced. And so, as is customary, today also I will discourse on this topic. I will announce the new year of Waqf-e-Jadeed, and I will provide a report in some details of the previous year of Waqf-e-Jadeed. With the grace of God the Almighty, the 58th year of Waqf-e-Jadeed concluded on the 31st of December 2015, and through His grace, members were enabled to make contributions to Waqf-e-Jadeed during the year, standing at 6,891,155 pounds sterling. This is an increase of 682,000 pounds from the last year. Once again, Pakistan tops the list of countries in the world where Jamaats are established in overall contribution to Waqf-e-Jadeed. Before revealing the rank of the other countries, I would like to provide some of the details of Waqf-e-Jadeed. As mentioned, £6.89 million was collected in Waqf-e-Jadeed in 2015. A third of the total collections from the poor or underdeveloped countries who contribute to Waqf-e-Jadeed remains within those very countries and is spent on local projects and endeavours. Some of the poor and underdeveloped countries also make contributions to Waqf-e-Jadeed. Out of the remaining two-thirds, half is spent in Jamaats or the Ahmadiyya community chapters in Qadian and in India, as explained earlier when Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV was cited relating to the aims and the purpose of Waqf-e-Jadeed. The remainder portion is spent in Africa and also in other countries. In India alone, 19 mosques have now been built this year, whilst 2 mosques are presently or currently under construction. 23 mission houses were built during the year in India, whilst 4 mission houses are presently under construction. In addition, expenditure was on various projects in Qadian, including relating to the Jalsa Gah. The Jalsa Gah is the area where attendees convene for the Jalsa, the annual convention in Qadian. The Jamaats of India, Nepal and Bhutan are controlled and supervised here by the Wakalat Tamil or Tanfeed department. But nonetheless, in Nepal, this year 2 proper mosques were built and 2 makeshift mosques were constructed. The construction of mosques and mission houses is given special attention everywhere. In India, a delegation visited a Jamaat, a local chapter of the Ahmadiyya community, in a local village after a very long time. The people of that village said, "We have been Ahmadis for a long time. However, there is neither any mosque nor any mission house for us to avail of here. The opponents taunt us that the Ahmadiyya community has been wiped out here and their center in that province is also non-existent. Thus, the opponents say to us to leave the Ahmadiyya community as there is no point of us remaining in it. And so this is how so many of the conversions in the past have gone to waste, because contact was not kept with them. And until we have mosques, until we have mission houses, and until we have mu'allimeen, teachers versed in religious education, such jamaat cannot remain established. Some people object that where have all the people gone who converted there? Many of them were lost simply because we were unable to maintain contact with them. Thus, the current plan is that wherever people do bayat, the initiation into the community, and a jamaat is established of a sizable number, there mosques and mission houses should be built, whether in Africa or India or elsewhere. In addition, naturally, with projects and plans, there is expenditure. In India, a large number of tarbiyat classes and refresher courses were held during the year, and expenditure had to be made on that. If we take the mu'allimeen, the dedicated religious teachers, alone in India, then at present they number 1,127. There is considerable expense on their allowance, on their accommodation, and on their travel expenditure. Then in 26 countries of Africa, there are presently 1,287 local mu'allimeen serving in their duties. In some villages, alongside the construction of the mosques, houses or facilities were provided to accommodate the mu'allimeen, the dedicated religious teachers. As I have mentioned, that where jamaats or local chapters of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community are established, it is imperative that mu'allimeen are sent to maintain and keep those jamaats established. Although the total number of mu'allimeen is very small in comparison to the very large numbers that we require, but nonetheless we need to continue making every effort possible. And so where we are unable to build permanent accommodation, we have to rent out accommodation for these mu'allimeen. For example, at present in Africa, there are 372 jamaats where we have rented out accommodation for the mu'allimeen. This year in Africa, 130 mosques were fully constructed, whilst 47 mosques are currently under construction. This year we plan to build 95 mosques there. And in 18 countries of Africa, 82 mission houses have been built. Whilst in 13 countries of Africa, 21 mission houses are presently being built, and there are also similarly other construction projects which are ongoing. In Africa, tarbiyat, moral and spiritual training classes, as well as refresher courses, are held for new converts, those who enter into the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. In approximately 2,155 locations of Africa, around 27,000 tarbiyat classes and refresher courses have been held, and around 100,000 new converts attended these various classes and refresher courses. 1,132 imams received training. As I have mentioned, for the Talim and the Tarbiyat, the religious education and moral and spiritual training of new Ahmadis, and to train them to be active members of the Nizami Jamaat, the system of the community, Talim and Tarbiyat classes were held in various countries. Many sincere non-Ahmadi Muslim imams take the bayat, the initiation into the community, and enter into Ahmadiyyat. So classes are essential for them to give them new training and tarbiyat, moral and spiritual training, to teach them about the correct Islam, about doctrines and about the issues. And thus, as I have mentioned, the imams are also included in this training. Training classes are held at various times of the year, ranging from 1 to 2 weeks. And this requires expenditure for their accommodation, it requires expenses for their food and expenses for other things. According to the reports I have received and that are before me, here I would like to say that Burkina Faso and Niger need to give more attention, as considerable improvements can be made in areas where there are shortcomings on their part. I previously detailed the increase in contributors to the Waqf-e Jadid scheme. Now I shall present some details of the contributors to Waqf-e Jadid. In 2010, there were 600,000 contributors to the Waqf-e Jadid scheme. At the time, I counseled the Jamaats, especially, that the Tarbiyat, the moral and spiritual training, would not be possible until the new members into Ahmadiyyat were included in the financial contribution system of Jannah. Now, with the grace of Allah the Almighty, the total number of contributors has reached to above 1.2 million for Waqf-e Jadid. But even now, there is plenty of room for improvement, because as I have said, it is essential we go on reminding people to join the financial contribution system of Jannah. Certainly, Allah the Almighty says that without financial sacrifice, one cannot progress in their faith. Further, the Jannah system, the system of financial contribution within the Ahmadiyya community, is such that it provides a way for contact to be maintained, and those who contribute witness firsthand the blessings of financial contribution, which leads to greater enthusiasm. I shall just now present a few accounts relating to this before you. From Tanzania, our missionary writes that a new Ahmadi lady from a village had taken the bayat, the initiation into the community, only a month ago. She was informed about the blessings of Waqf-e Jadid and replied that although she did not have any money to give, she did not want to deprive herself of these blessings as the year for Waqf-e Jadid was coming to an end, and said to wait for just a moment. Thus she went home and picked up the eggs that were in her house, and she proceeded to the market where she sold those eggs. She received 2,000 shillings for this sale. She duly returned and handed over the money for Waqf-e Jadid. Now this lady had only become an Ahmadi 1 month prior to this, yet she fully realized the importance of financial contribution and of the system of Jannah. Then there is another lady who is a new Ahmadi, and she also had nothing at home to eat, yet she handed over whatever money she had to Jannah. She relates that after giving the money she had, that she had been owed money for a very long time from someone who had borrowed money from her, but this person was not returning that money which they had taken as a loan from her. Immediately after giving Jannah, she received a message from that person saying that they had the money to give back and that she should come to collect it. And that amount was 4 or 5 times greater than the amount this lady had given towards Jannah or towards financial contribution. A lady from the Gambia took the bet, the initiation into the Ahmadiyya community, 2 years ago and had been married for the last 10 years. When an appeal was made for the Waqf-e Jadid last year, she contributed according to her capacity and she also wrote to me for prayers, that is, wrote to Hadrat Khalifatul Masih V. With the grace of Allah the Almighty, she has now been blessed with having twins, and she remarked that she now understood the blessings of financial contribution of Jannah. Staying in the Gambia, Amir Sahib, the national president of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community in the Gambia, writes that a friend from a village was so ill for 1 year that he could neither walk nor go about anywhere, nor could he carry out any work nor any employment. His financial circumstances were extremely dire as a result of this. When reminders were made or an appeal was made last year for Waqf-e Jadid, he had with him 5 dalasi currency, which had been given to him as sadaqah or alms of charity. He duly gave these 5 dalasi he possessed towards Waqf-e Jadid. Allah the Almighty blessed him and his work so profusely that this individual, who couldn't even walk or go about anywhere, now owns a herd of animals and also does farming. He expressed that all of these bounties and grace bestowed upon him by God the Almighty, where his crops have returned a good harvest, and he has a herd of animals, are blessings purely he received due to giving Jannah, or giving towards financial contribution. Again from the Gambia, Amir Sahib, the national president of the Ahmadiyya community in the Gambia, writes that a lady's husband had disappeared suddenly 7 years ago. She had remained extremely distressed and worried, and people would say to her that so much time has elapsed since your husband went missing, which means he must have died, you are better off marrying again. But she would refuse to remarry. Nonetheless, when she was approached to give Chanda Waqfe Jadeed, she handed over 5 dalasi in contribution. She relates that after doing so, she attained a peace and tranquility of the mind. Not only this, but 2 months after, her husband suddenly returned in good health. He had been either trapped somewhere or had ended up in a location from where it was extremely difficult for him to return. So thus the situation was resolved for her in this manner, that 1, her husband came back, and 2, with the grace of Allah the Almighty, they now have a daughter born to them. From Finland, a person writes that last year he had pledged 510 euros towards Chanda Waqfe Jadeed. However, this year, as his financial circumstances had worsened, he thought he would pledge 100 euros as he would be unable to give more. He said, "I was chastised by God the Almighty for this in the following way. One day, all of a sudden, my car broke down on the road and I had to take it to the mechanics for repair. The total bill for the repair was exactly the amount he had previously pledged, 510 euros. Upon returning home, he immediately said that in reality, Allah the Almighty was teaching him a lesson, and he promptly fulfilled his pledge for Waqfe Jadeed and gave over the amount towards the full contribution. In Sierra Leone, an Ahmadi lady is the headmistress of a primary school. She says that the missionary reminded us or gave an appeal about Waqfe Jadeed. She says that I did not have anything to give, as I had already contributed previously. She says her brother had become Christian a long time ago and angrily left for the US and said to her that she should also renounce her religion to become Christian and join her. She had given a financial contribution with great difficulty due to her circumstances and plight. In any case, the brother one day called her and said to her that, "You can stay a Muslim and an Ahmadi. I have no objection. However, I have been inspired to support you, and thus I am sending you a large amount of money." Thus, the sister was able to re-establish connection with her brother, and also she gained financial affluence. From India, a missionary writes that a friend in Coimbatore went to the shops to buy some jewellery for his daughter. He was looking at the jewellery he liked when Juma, or the time for Friday prayer, approached just then. He said to the shopkeeper that he would go for the Friday prayer and then return to purchase the jewellery. The summary of my Friday sermon was read out, in which I announced the new year for the Tahreek-e-Jadeed. I spoke of financial contribution, and I also narrated an incident of a blind lady's financial sacrifice. And so this had such an impact on this member that instead of spending his money on the jewellery as he had intended, he paid it towards his remaining Waqfe Jadeed promise. When he came out of the mosque and mentioned this to his wife, she was very happy and said that she too had the same thought, that they should give this money towards Chanda, towards financial contribution, and God Almighty will make other provisions for them to purchase the jewellery for their daughter. The inspector for Waqfe Jadeed in Saharanpur, India, writes that he went to an Ahmadi's house in a village in UP, Uttar Pradesh, for the Waqfe Jadeed collection. The Ahmadi gentleman told his wife that Eid, the Muslim festival, was approaching. However, he only had 200 rupees with him. She could either make some clothes for herself, or she could pay that money towards the chanda. So she replied that the clothes can be made afterwards, but the chanda should be paid first. Now, only a few months had passed that the inspector went again to collect the chanda. He was extremely happy to see the house. The Ahmadi gentleman told him that they had received a lot of work since they paid their chanda. First, he would work on the fields using other people's tractor. However, now God the Almighty blessed him so much that he had brought his own tractor and had been immensely blessed in his work. Staying in India, the Arisa Jamaat, there is a place called Jugatgiri, I think it is in Orissa. However, wherever it is, there was a person who was heavily under debt, and due to this he would hide from other people. He secretly left his hometown and travelled to Hyderabad, still in India. When the missionary or the inspector of Waqf-e Jadid found out about his whereabouts, they went to see him and told him about the importance of chanda. Somehow he was able to pay his chanda, his financial contribution, and also remained in contact with the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat. After this, God the Almighty blessed him so much so that he began to receive a regular income, and God the Almighty enabled him to pay off his debts. However, not only was he able to pay off his debts, which were causing him to hide from people, but he was now able to buy his own house. He also increased his Waqf-e Jadid promise manifold. The inspector for Waqf-e Jadid for Bengal and Sikkim writes that a person from a local Jamaat joined Ahmadiyyat 10 years ago. He was always at the forefront of financial sacrifice. This year, when he was approached regarding the Waqf-e Jadid budget, he said that he was experiencing a lot of financial difficulty because his father recently had an operation and he spent 100,000 rupees. He therefore reduced his promise from 22,000 rupees, which was quite a large sum, to 17,000 rupees. However, when the time came for collection, he gave 22,000 rupees. He said that he thought, why should he limit a good deed, which he had already started? Thus, God Almighty increases one's faith and makes people realize themselves that they should offer sacrifices so that they can increasingly become the recipients of God the Almighty's grace, bounties and blessings. An Ahmadi from Mauritius says that in 2015, when I announced the new year, that is when Hadrat Khalifatul Masih V announced the new year for the Waqf-e Jadid, he fell into deep thought as he had never contributed towards this chanda. He says, while the sermon was going on, I promised to God Almighty that if I find work, I will pay 25,000 Mauritian rupees, which is approximately £500, towards Waqf-e Jadid. He says that a few days later, I received a contract for employment worth 500,000 rupees, and I was certain that God Almighty has granted me 20 times more than the amount that I promised. The first thing he did after receiving the contract was to pay his chanda. Benin is a country in Africa where there is a very devout Ahmadi, Amusu Kadus Sahib. He is only young, 16 or 17, and worked as a labourer in order to pay his chanda. His brother was ill, and despite being treated in various leading hospitals, there was no improvement in his health. He was very worried and also wrote to me for prayers, that is to Hadrat Khalifatul Masih V, and continued to pray himself, and paid 100 franc towards chanda. He had paid the chanda especially with the thought of his brother's health, and to improve it. Therefore, God the Almighty blessed him so much so, that his brother was miraculously cured from his illness. The missionary who relates this account says that they told him that since his brother was ill, he may need this money, therefore he should not pay his chanda now, and instead pay it later. However, this person refused to pay it later. Thus he paid in cash, and God the Almighty rewarded him immediately. An Ahmadi member in Benin writes that he regularly pays his chanda. He says that on the 4th of December 2015, a large group of thieves or robbers were stealing buffaloes and arrived at his village and also took all his buffaloes whilst threatening him using weapons. The group of thieves had only left the village when a very powerful storm broke and all the cows and buffaloes became frightened and ran, and the thieves could not control them. The Ahmadi gentleman's cows returned back to him. In fact, the other animals also came there and were then returned back to their owners. However, he told all the villagers that their animals have returned back to them because of him, as he is among those who regularly pay the chanda. So such is the progress in faith made by those in far-off lands in Africa after having entered the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, that is the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, on whom be peace. Regarding a Jamaat, a local chapter of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community in Australia, the secretary for Waqf-e-Jadeed writes that there was a lady who heard the previous year's Friday sermon on Waqf-e-Jadeed, and it had a great impact on her. She had $2,000 with her and immediately gave them. Similarly, our missionary from Australia writes about an incident regarding a child. The missionary writes that while he was talking to the family, the child was sat nearby listening. After a short while, he brought a small toy car and took out $200 from it and said that this was for Waqf-e-Jadeed from him. Amir Sahib Norway, the national president of the Ahmadiyya community in Norway, writes that a Norwegian lady, who is a new convert, was informed of Waqf-e-Jadeed and immediately paid 200 Norwegian kroner. A few days later, she said, "The day after I gave Chanda, my boss summoned me to give me a pay rise of 200 kron, even though she did not put in any kind of request or demand." She also said that she had only given 200 kron once, however, she is receiving an extra 200 kron every month now. There is an Ahmadi in Congo Kinshasa who recently did the bet, the oath of allegiance and initiation. He was informed of the Jamaat's financial system and he immediately began to regularly pay his chanda. This new Ahmadi says that due to his chanda, his financial situation has greatly improved. Before, whatever work he would try his hand in would never be fruitful. However, since he started to regularly pay his chanda, God Almighty has blessed him so much that he now has his own cows and his livelihood has become immensely blessed. The National Secretary for Waqf-e-Jadeed in Germany writes that there was a seminar held in one of the Jamaats in Germany. A lady who is a new convert also attended. The Sadr Lajna told him that after the seminar, this lady paid a large sum of 400 euros towards Waqf-e-Jadeed. She is the only Ahmadi in her family and faces a lot of opposition. May God the Almighty remove this opposition. The Amir Sahib of Canada, the national president of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community Canada, said that a Khadim, a young male Ahmadi, paid $25,000 towards Humanity First for the Syrian refugees, but told them to keep his name confidential. Initially, he was in Safi Awwal, the high-paying band for Waqf-e-Jadeed, or perhaps he was asked to be joined in Safi Awwal. But he was a little hesitant and promised that he will be in Safi Dom, the second paying band. However, when it came to the time of collecting chanda, he said that he would pay according to the rate of those in Safi Awwal, and therefore they should include him in that category. A missionary of Tanzania writes that a few years ago, one of the members converted to Ahmadiyyat from Christianity. He says, last year in Ramadan, some of the shops were burnt down due to a fire that broke out in the marketplace and all of the stock of my shop was completely reduced to ashes. I was solely dependent on this shop and could not think of what to do now. Some of the other shop owners suggested that I would take a loan from the bank on interest and restart my business, just as some of the neighboring shop owners were doing. However, I said that God Almighty is fully aware of my situation and my needs. Look how God the Almighty increases people's trust in God, and how he grew strong in his faith after converting to Ahmadiyya from Christianity. He said, I will certainly not do anything which God Almighty has forbidden, therefore I will not take an interest-based loan, even if it seems to be apparently advantageous. He says, some of the local Jamaat members helped me, and some of them helped me without me even asking them. And so I was able to start to work again, and God Almighty blessed me so much that immediately after starting work, I increased my chanda, and I paid more than I had promised. He says, it had not even been 6 months since my shop burnt down, that God Almighty had blessed my livelihood so much that this new shop is attracting so much business that that I had not earned so much in 6 months compared to what I was earning now so quickly. My wife was ill, and she too, by the grace of God the Almighty, is much better now. He says that this is all due to spending in the way of God the Almighty. It has been mentioned in a hadith, a saying of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there is a blessing spending in the way of God the Almighty with wealth that is pure. We can see that how God Almighty rewarded this person who said that he will not acquire wealth through unlawful means. Instead, he took some help and borrowed some money and started his business, and thus God Almighty blessed him. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, has stated that even a date seed which has been acquired with pure wealth can turn into a mountain. He also stated that a calf eventually becomes a mature animal. Similarly, sacrifices made from a pure wealth are increased by God the Almighty. God Almighty shows such wonders to the members of the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him's community. As I mentioned earlier, now I will present the report for the previous year of Waqf-e Jadeed. After Pakistan, the country which is ranked first and number two among the whole world, but number one among the countries outside of Pakistan, is the United Kingdom. The second is the United States of America, third is Germany, fourth is Canada, fifth is India, sixth is Australia, at the seventh position is Indonesia, eighth is a Jamaat in the Middle East, ninth is Belgium, and the tenth is Ghana. In terms of increase in the collection based on the local currency, Ghana is first, after them is the United States of America, and then is the United Kingdom. With regards to the contribution per person among the larger Jamaats, first is a Jamaat from the Middle East, then the United States, then another Middle Eastern Jamaat, fourth is Switzerland, fifth is the United Kingdom, sixth is Australia, seventh is Belgium, 8th is Belgium, 9th is Germany, and 10th is Canada. As I mentioned, that by the grace of God the Almighty, this year more than 1.2 million people took part in the Waqf-e Jadeed scheme. 1,235,000 people, and this is an increase of 600,000 from the previous year. In terms of contributors, apart from Africa, India is number one, then Canada, then the United Kingdom, and then the United States of America. These countries have made an outstanding increase. However, the most increase has been made in African countries. Among the African countries, Nigeria is first, then Cameroon, Guinea-Conakry, Niger, Burkina Faso, Mali, Benin, Tanzania, and then Uganda. The first three are top-ranked Jamaats in terms of adult contributions is Lahore at first, second is Rabwa, and third is Karachi. The rank or the positions for the districts amongst Pakistan is Faisalabad is first, then Sargodha, Gujranwala, Gujarat, Multan, Umarkot, Narowal, Hyderabad, and Bahawalpur. The first three ranked Jamaats in Pakistan for the Atfal is Lahore at first, second Karachi, and third is Rabwa. The position for the districts is first is Islamabad, second is Faisalabad, and third is Gujranwala, fourth Gujarat, fifth Hyderabad, sixth Dera Ghazi Khan, seventh Multan, 8. Kotli Azad Kashmir, 9. Mirpur Khas, and 10th Peshawar. The top ranked position for the large Jamaats in the United Kingdom is 1st Worcester Park, Brains Park next, then Birmingham West, Fuzzle Mosque, Wimbledon Park, Gillingham, South Cheam, New Malden, Bradford South, and then Glasgow. In terms of the total collections for Waqf-e Jadeed for the regions in the United Kingdom, Midlands is first, then the North East, London A, London B, And then Middlesex. In terms of collection, the first 10 Jamaats ranked of the United States of America are Silicon Valley, Seattle, Detroit, Central Virginia, Los Angeles East, Silver Spring, York, Harrisburg, Boston, Houston North, and then Dallas. In terms of total collection, the first 5 local regions in Germany are Frankfurt is first, then Grossgorow, Wiesbaden, Moorfelden, and then Holdorf. And the 10 Jamaats in terms of the overall contribution for Waqf e Jadid are Rodermark, Neuss, Reidelberg, Florisheim, Koblenz, Hanover, Nida, Wingarten, and Fulda. Out of the 3 Jamaats in Canada, first is Calgary, second is Vaughan, third is Vancouver. Out of the 5 big Jamaats in Canada, Milton and Georgetown are number 1, then Durham, then Edmonton West, Saskatoon North, and then Ottawa West. Amongst the Atfal, there are 5 prominent Jamaats in Canada. Durham is first, then Calgary Northwest, Milton, Georgetown, then Peace Village East, and Woodbridge. I have directed attention towards this many times in the past that the work being done in an organized manner in the Office of Atfal in Canada, the rest of the countries worldwide should also focus their attention towards this and do work accordingly. In this regard, I would like to mention here that the Office of Atfal is only in Waqf e Jadid and not in Tahreek e Jadid. In regards to the overall collection for Waqf e Jadid in India, Kerala is first, Tamil Nadu is second, Jammu Kashmir, then Telangana, then Karnataka, then West Bengal, then Orissa, Punjab, then Uttar Pradesh, Delhi, and Maharashtra. In terms of collection, the other Jamaats are as follows. First is Kerala, Calicut is second, then Hyderabad, then Pattabhiram, then Gadian, then Kannur town, then Calcutta, then Sulur, then Bangalore, Bangardi, and then Rishinagar. The top 10 Jamaats of Australia for Waqf e Jadid are Melbourne South, Castle Hill, Mount Druitt, Bezeth, Adelaide South, Plimpton, Brisbane South, Brisbane Logan, Marsden Park, and Blacktown. So as I said, in Australia or somewhere else, someone asked me a question that is there an office of Atfal in Waqf e Jadid? Is there one in Tehreek e Jadid as well? So it should be clarified here that there is no office in Atfal for Tehreek e Jadid. The donations collected from Atfal are especially emphasized for Waqf e Jadid, and there is a separate office for this. May Allah, the Almighty, immensely bless the wealth and lives of those who offered sacrifice. May He enable them to offer more sacrifice this year. May the number of participants increase as well. Now after the Friday prayers, I will lead 2 funeral prayers in absentia. The first funeral is of respected Muhammad Aslam Shad Mangla Sahib, who passed away on the night of the 31st of December 2015 at 10:40 p.m. He was approximately 71 years old. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. He was suffering from a heart problem and went to hospital for a checkup. As soon as the doctor saw him, he said that his condition is not stable and he was admitted. He then suffered a heart attack and was shifted to a ventilator. Then he suffered from an attack of stroke and another heart attack also. Then he suffered from problem with the kidneys, as well as dialysis was done continuously. Recovery proved difficult when he suffered from a third heart attack right there at the hospital despite the shock treatment, and then at last he passed away. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. His father's name was Haji Saleh Muhammad Mangla. He was from 168 to 171 Jak Mangla Sargoda. His mother's name was Sahib Bibi. In 1955, 80 people from the area of Jak Mangla came to Rabwa under the leadership of his father, Haji Muhammad Saleh Sahib, and they took the bet, the oath of allegiance, at the hand of Hadhrat Musleh Maud, the second Khalifa. Hadhrat Musleh Maud has mentioned that a group of people met him. Respected Muhammad Aslam Shah Mangla Sahib was in this group amongst the children. At that time, his age was only 10 years. He finished his primary education in his village. Then his father brought him for admission in a school in Rabwa. He was admitted in Talimul Quran High School in the 6th grade. His father handed him over to Hadhrat Khalifat al-Masih III, Sahibzada Mirza Nasir Ahmad, who was a principal of that college, and said to him that, "I am handing a sparrow to you. You make him a falcon." Therefore, Hadhrat Khalifat al-Masih III replied, "All right, inshallah, God willing, he will become a falcon." And mashallah, Allah the Almighty enabled him to do a lot of service afterwards. He passed his matriculation examination in 1961. Then he finished his BA from Talimul Islam College. He did MA Arabic from Punjab University with a distinction. After completing his MA in Arabic in 1966, he worked as a lecturer in Talimul Islam College, Rabwa, for 14 years until 1980. Either in 1974 or 1975, the government nationalized schools and colleges. Anyways, in 1980, the government transferred Ahmadi teachers to different locations. He wanted to serve the Jamaat and he was not satisfied with the situation, so he resigned from that other post. And he presented himself to Hadhrat Khalifat al-Masih III to devote his life to the services of the religion. His Holiness Hazur said, "Come to my office." Hazur Hadhrat Khalifat al-Masih III appointed him at the private secretary's office, and after 3 months he was appointed as an assistant private secretary. In 1982, Hadhrat Khalifat al-Masih IV appointed him as private secretary, and until his demise he served as private secretary in Rabwa. He got the opportunity to serve as the private secretary for 1 year approximately when Hadhrat Khalifat al-Masih IV migrated to London. From 1982 up to his demise, he got the opportunity to serve as Secretary Majlis-e-Shura. From 1968 till 1983, he served Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya in various positions. From 1986 till 2015, he got the opportunity to serve Ansarullah in various positions, and at present he was serving as the Naib Sadr of Majlis Ansarullah. He has left behind his wife, 6 sons and 2 daughters. May Allah the Almighty grant them patience and enable them to continue with his good deeds. One of his sons, Muhammad Nayyar Mangla, is a missionary and he works in the research cell in Rabwa. The other son, Atiq Mangla, is a Waqf-e-No and he is a medical lab technician. His son-in-law says that respected Muhammad Aslam Shah Mangla Sahib possessed many qualities and he used to face every type of difficulty himself with great courage. And he said, "I never heard an expression of pain or suffering uttered from his tongue. His entire life was devoted for the service of the religion and the faith. Morning, evening, day and night, all the time he was busy with Jamaat work, and he actually fulfilled the rite of his waqf, his life devotion." Hazur says that, "I have witnessed this myself." His son, Nayyar Ahmed, says that he would wake up for tahajjud prayers and he would instruct his family to do so as well. He used to pray with immense gentleness and passion. He would take children with him when attending prayers in congregation. His daughter Abida says that he had a lot of trust in Allah the Almighty. He was a person of great courage and ambition. He would not utter anything from his tongue or express any signs of discomfort on the face of any difficulty. Rather, he would cry in front of God the Almighty and beseech his help, and he would write to the Khalifa of the time. He would always seek guidance from the Khalifa of the time for his affairs, whether the matter was significant or insignificant. He was very particular in taking care of his relatives. His daughter-in-law says that he possessed countless qualities. He was a person of gentle temperament. He was very hospitable and social. He never mentioned any office-related matters at home. If we used to hear about something from outside, he would say, "Oh, you heard something. Go ahead and tell me about it as well." He never discussed anything office-related matter at home. Hazur says his daughter-in-law is a daughter of Aslam Bronash Sahib Shaheed. She says that after the martyrdom of my father, he took care of me even more. He gave his daughter-in-laws a status in the household. Daughter-in-laws were consulted whenever there was an issue. Hazur says this is the proper way to make homes paradise-like. His nephew says that, "I saw every moment of his life being sacrificed for the sake of the Jamaat and Khilafat. He had a very strong relation and bond with Khilafat." Dr. Masood Al-Hassan Nuri Sahib writes that, "I had the opportunity to closely observe some qualities of respected Mangla Sahib for 8 years. The prominent features amongst his qualities which I have noticed are as follows. I found him to be humble in nature, very high in morals, compassionate, social, and a person who was free from arrogance and hatred. A very humble man. Despite diabetes, blood pressures and heart problems, he would offer his 5 daily prayers at the mosque with preparation. He was a loyal servant and very sincere to Khilafat," says Bashir Ahmed Sahib, a worker in the private secretary's office. He says, "I had the opportunity to work with him for 22 years, and he would always cooperate with me in a loving and affectionate manner. He would always guide me." Wasim Sahib, a worker in the private secretary's office, says, "This humble one's residence was besides Mangla Sahib's residence. Once my mother was sick and he repeatedly asked me about her health." Mirza Dawood Sahib, a worker in private secretary's office, said, "I worked with Mangla Sahib for 24 years and he always put his trust in me. He supervised the work and provided guidance. If someone would get upset, he would call that person in immediately and try to please him." Khalid Imran Sahib, a worker in the Hifaz-e-Khas, says that he possessed countless qualities. However, the attribute of forgiveness was most prominent. Regardless of how upset he would be with a worker, upon his apology, Mangla Sahib would immediately forgive and not hold any grudge against that person. Salim Zafar Sahib, a worker here at the private secretary's office, also said that, "There is a very old relation with Mangla Sahib, and I do not remember any incident when he had an argument with someone or he was upset at someone permanently. He would always smile." Ataul Mujib Rashid Sahib, the Imam of the Fazl Mosque, says that, "I had a long relation with him. We worked together for Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya headquarters in various capacities. We stayed in touch afterwards as well. His love and faith for Khilafat and sense of responsibility were most prominent qualities." He says that in those days when programs such as Liqam al-Arab and other Q&A sessions were recorded, many times according to the instruction of Hadrat Khalifat al-Masih IV, I had the opportunity to contact him to obtain various information. Mangla Sahib would send the required information immediately that I used to present. Malik Naseem Sahib says that, "Mangla Sahib was the Mu'tamim Muqami and I was the Nazim Khidmat-e-Khalq in Rabwa. Once there was an accident. He came to my house at 11:30 at night on his bicycle and said, 'An accident has occurred and there are patients in Faisalabad. Go there immediately with the Khuddam. I have arranged a car. Some people need blood. Make arrangements accordingly.' He says that it was cold. I said, 'Mangla Sahib, drink tea before leaving.' He replied, 'It is not time for tea. People are dying. Go there immediately.' At that time, he was suffering from a severe flu and fever. Regardless of that, his sense of responsibility was such that he rode his bicycle and went to the residence of Nazim Khidmat-e-Khalq personally and sent him with a prepared team." Hazur says that there is not an iota of exaggeration in the qualities that everyone has mentioned regarding Mangla Sahib, including the children and the outsiders as well. I have mentioned this before that in my opinion his qualities were a lot more than what has been mentioned here. I had a connection with him for a long time. Perhaps he taught me in a college for a few days when he came to college in the beginning. Later on, I worked with him in Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya and Ansarullah. Afterwards, when Hadrat Khalifat al-Masih IV appointed me as the Nazir-e-Ala, I was constantly in direct contact with him. I have always witnessed him to be very obedient, very much prepared for work, and he would work with a great sense of responsibility. Then after Khilafat, whenever I gave him any work, he did it. His humility and humbleness was such that many times I called him here for Jalsa, and whenever he would come here, he would sit with all the workers in the office and work. He never said that as I am the private secretary in Pakistan, I should get a separate desk and chair here. He would sit with all the other workers in general and would take care of even the most insignificant tasks. May Allah the Almighty elevate his status and treat him with mercy and forgiveness. The second funeral prayer is of Ahmed Sher Joya Sahib, who was the son of Hakim Saleh Muhammad Joya Sahib. He used to live in Belgium and passed away at the age of 67. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. He worked as a social worker there. He was particular in prayers. He was a very loving, kind towards the poor, righteous and sincere human being. He has left behind two daughters and three sons. One of his sons, Osama Joya, graduated from Jamia UK and is currently serving as a missionary of the Jamaat in the Mayotte Island. He was not able to attend his father's funeral prayers because he was in the field. Doctors had declared Ahmad Sher Joya Sahib as incurable due to cancer and stated he has only a few days left to live. Respected Osama Joya, who is a missionary, was here during those days and he was also worried because of his father's illness. However, his father told him that your duty is to stay in the field. Do not worry about my illness. Go and fulfill the responsibility which has been entrusted upon you by the Jamaat and the Khalifa of the time. So his father forcefully sent him and passed away a few days later. May Allah the Almighty immerse him with His mercy. May Allah the Almighty grant patience to respected Osama Joya Sahib, who is busy serving the religion. May Allah the Almighty enable him to serve the faith and religion even more than before, and may he be able to fulfill the virtuous desires of his parents. By the grace of Allah the Almighty, all the missionaries and Muballighin graduating from here are doing a lot of work. May Allah the Almighty permanently establish their humility, capability and ambition to work.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر.